You're tuned in to Around the Country here on WRAF with Lil and George. And my guest today for the interview portion of Around the Country is Ron Rhodes. We go around the country to Dallas, Texas. Welcome, Ron, to our program today.
Well, thank you. It's good to be with you today.
And good to be with you again. You know, every time I turn around, Ron, I see another book written by Ron Rhodes. How many books have you written now?
Well, I've written over 50 books last count. And I read an article, a review, that said somebody must have locked Ron Rhodes in a closet with a typewriter. But that's not the case. I just enjoy writing, and I start off every morning writing, and then I do ministry for the rest of the day.
Well, we are the recipients of that, and grateful recipients, may I say. Ron, I every time receive one of your books, I am just thrilled with it.
Well, thank
and
you.
The last one I received here now is Cyber Meltdown. And to me, this, it took me a bit to get my mind wrapped around Ron Rhodes, Bible Prophecy and Cyber Meltdown. You know, some might think this is a strange partnering of subjects.
Well, you know, that's a possibility, but what I like to do is to keep my eye on what's going on in America. And, you know, Jesus told us to be accurate observers of the times and to be ready to recognize any correlations that exist between current events and the biblical prophecies. And just to give you one example of the connection between prophecy and, you know, cyberspace, the Bible does indicate in Revelation 13 that one day during the tribulation period, the Antichrist and the false prophet will control the world economy. And almost without exception, scholars believe that one thing that will be required for that is a cashless society. In other words, if we had cash, $10 bills and $20 bills and so forth, you really couldn't enforce that very well. Hmm. But if we were a cashless society, it would be an easy thing to do. And as you know, today we are becoming increasingly cashless. In fact, the amount of cash being used today is half that used in the 1970s.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, it's amazing. And over 70% of all transactions today are electronic in nature. And so, you know, that's where we're headed. That's a legitimate correlation, I think. And I think it's sort of setting the stage for what's to come.
You know, I'm kind of old-fashioned, and even more so probably than my husband.
You and me both.
And I said, oh, I'll never quit, you know, handling cash, you know. And my husband was using one of those credit debit cards long before me. I didn't want to bother with it. And if we were together, I'd say, you do it. I don't know how to do it. But you know what? I'm doing it now. I find myself doing it. And so I'm going against everything in my fiber about this.
Well, you know, it's interesting how things change, isn't it? You know,
yeah.
I was reading an article in which the chief executive of Visa, you know, the Visa card.
Yes.
And he said that within 5 years, it's entirely possible that you may end up having to pay a surcharge if you try to use cash. Now, just imagine that. You pull out a $20 bill to pay for something, and then they tell you, well, we've got to add an extra $2 because you're using cash.
Yeah, got to handle the cash.
Yeah.
Oh, my, that's terrible. I don't want to think about it.
I don't either, I'll tell you.
Okay. All right, now, before we go any further here, we need to clarify cyberspace. Now, I am not a techie. I read books, and I love to lose myself in reading books, and I interview authors, and I do a little bit of emailing because of the work that I do.
Sure.
But I am not, I'm just not good with the computer at all. But we need to understand, and I know there's a lot more people like me too, what is cyberspace and why should we as Christians care about it?
Well, you know, that's a great question. I think that a lot of people, they hear about cyberspace in the evening news and they read about it in magazines and newspapers, and a lot of people just assume that it must be the internet.
Yeah.
And it does include the internet, but it also includes, for example, the stock market, all the banks that are interconnected with each other, and all the corporations and companies out there that have their own internal networks at companies. Anything that's connected is part of cyberspace. Even your water utilities and your electric utilities are connected to computers which control them, and so that's part of cyberspace as well. So again, all the stuff that's connected in our world, all the millions of computers and networks, that's what we call cyberspace.
All right. Just so we understand, it's all out there, invisible, but it's everywhere.
It's there, you know, the thing of it is that it seems like the wave of the future all connects in some way to cyberspace, mm-hmm. and I think that's one reason why we as Christians ought to at least be aware of it.
Absolutely. Well, as I told you, I'm a book person, and I want you to know, Ron, that when I read a book, I read everything in it. I read the dedication, like you dedicated this book to your mother.
Yes.
Didn't you? And I read the acknowledgments, and I read the thank yous and everything that goes, because lots of times you can find funny little things in there. Well, what I found was not anything funny. You started your book with a quote from Phil Elmore, and in that he says, "Every minute of the day, external foes are mounting assaults on American infrastructure, civilian American assets, and American military targets. And these enemies do this through the virtual world." Wow. What is going on?
Well, it is pretty amazing out there. You know, just in terms of the security events that take place at the United States Senate, every month that passes, there are 1.8 billion cyber attacks against our Senate. And there are 13.9 million computer attacks launched each and every day against the Senate Security Operations Center. It's just frightening when you think about it, but you know, it's not just our country, but it's us as individuals as well. Did you know that 73% of people in the world have experienced some form of cybercrime? That's kind of scary. That's 3 out of 4 people on our planet have been victims of cybercrime. And 55% have been victims of what they call computer viruses. You know what? I was a victim. I was writing a book, and a computer virus came in and erased my whole hard disk. So I learned the hard way the importance of making backups. But, you know, when I wrote this book, I did want to warn Christians without being alarmist. In other words, I don't want Christians to be sensationalistic about this or be paranoid about it. But part of being wise involves being educated about the danger. And so that's why I wrote the book.
Okay. But is it true that the United States is more vulnerable to cyber attacks than almost any other country in the world?
Well, I hate to say it, but that is true. And that's not just me saying that. That's our top experts who are acknowledging that. And the reason that I say that is quite simple. In the past, our country has had a lot of money to spend. That's not so much the case today, is it?
No, I'm afraid not.
But, you know, in the past, we've spent an awful lot of money on technology and computers and all kinds of high-tech stuff. And so we use computers much more than other countries do. We've got stuff connected like other countries don't have stuff connected. And as a result of that, we're more vulnerable to a cyber attack. And if a cyber attack that was effective was launched against the United States, all kinds of stuff could go haywire. In fact, it could wipe out the aviation radar system and computer system so that all the planes out there are flying blind. Major gas pipelines can be caused to explode as a result of a computer virus. It can cause all the traffic lights in the country to turn green at the same time.
Oh.
Boy, imagine that.
Yeah.
And subway trains crashing and blackouts. I mean, just all kinds of stuff can happen. And that's the number one reason why our own government today, as I speak, is spending hundreds of millions of dollars building up cyber defense, because our country wants to protect its citizens against this very sort of thing.
I understand from your book that in just recent years, when was it, 2009, I believe, that the United States formed a cyber military.
Yes, isn't that something?
Yeah, young men. Some of these are teenagers, right? they take those who are hacking in and get them to work for them.
Well, it's almost like they're hiring cyber geeks out there. And it is true, a lot of the young people in the country, even teenagers, are among the most talented computer hackers out there. And so not just the United States, but other countries as well are actually hiring teenagers and young computer geeks in order to tighten up their security. And when they do that, you know that they've got a desperate problem, because I don't know of any other situation where governments are hiring teenage geeks. But it is happening. And, You know, just about a couple of weeks ago, I don't know if you saw this in the newspaper, but our government's taken it so seriously that they have issued a public warning that if any country launches a cyber computer attack against our country, all options are on the table in terms of a response, including sending in the Marines with tanks and bazookas.
Mm.
So the idea is that if a country launches a computer attack against us, we may respond with physical force.
Well, I, for one, am glad that they are taking this seriously. I'm sure they realize it is serious when it can affect our country's infrastructures, you know, like shutting down all things electric. Where would we live? Well, what would we do? How would we live without electricity?
Well, that's right. And one of the things that our government has discovered, you know, based upon PhD-level computer experts in our country, is that already within our utilities, such as our electrical grid and our water utilities and all of that, foreign governments have already installed software code through the Internet into our own utility networks. And it's basically something that's called a logic bomb. I'm not sure why they call it that, but they call it a logic bomb. And these are in our networks all over the country, just awaiting a command from a foreign government. And once a foreign government issues that command, the electricity goes out, the water goes out. And so right now, one of the situations we've got going is we've got computer experts trying to eradicate all of that stuff that's taking place. And so, like you, I am very glad that our government is taking it seriously because it affects the place where we actually live in our own neighborhoods.
Yeah. That's really quite frightening. Are we in danger of cyber jihad from Muslim countries?
Well, you know, I've done a lot of research on that because if there's anybody out there that would like to hurt the United States, it would certainly include, militant Muslims out there.
Mm-hmm.
And it used to be that when Muslims wanted to launch a terrorist attack against the United States, they'd first have to get into the country. Number two, they'd have to spend millions of dollars to make everything work and to coordinate it.
But they have millions, usually.
Well, they do. They have the millions of dollars coming in from oil revenues.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's become a lot more convenient today to launch an attack because you don't necessarily have to come into our country. You can actually launch an attack from any other country by using computer technology. Even for less than $1,000, you can launch a significant cyber attack against another country. And get this, there are actually companies that you can hire on the Internet to design your cyber attacks for you. They will ask you, how much of a budget do you have? $1,000 a week? $10,000 a week? $100,000 a week? Whatever your budget is, these companies will custom design a cyber attack for you, and there's actually countries that are hiring these services. And it's become big business. Now, who would have ever thought that would be the case in our world?
Hmm.
But I think that one of the reasons why that sort of stuff exists today is that in most parts of the world, there are no laws regarding cyber crimes. So in other words, if you got caught, you couldn't be prosecuted because there's no law against it. Now, our government is taking steps in terms of laws, but most other countries don't have laws in place yet. And so, you know, people are getting away with murder out there.
Absolutely. And, it just boggles the mind when you think about someone going off crazy with this sort of thing and getting it started and getting it going. Where does it end? It ends in complete destruction.
Well, you know, I've always said that technology itself is neutral. You know, there's an awful lot of good that comes from this technology. You know, you've got ministry, you know, good Christian broadcasts and all of that are going out over the Internet. So there's some good to it. But there's also bad guys out there. And the bad guys are producing bad software designed to hurt you. And again, just so our listeners are very, very clear on this, it's not just our government and our country that's in danger. We are in danger, too. You know, for example, you might sign on to some website and you might see a web advertisement, a little banner advertisement. And you might think that you want to know more about that advertisement, so you click on it. Well, little do you know that in the background, a software program called malware, is being secretly downloaded to your computer, and that piece of malware is called a keyboard logger. It watches all your keyboard strokes. It watches when you sign on to your bank and your credit card service. And it's watching for your username and your passwords. And this is one of the ways that identity theft takes place. Why, people are even doing this with pornography. Young people are signing on to bad websites and clicking on pictures. And when they click on pictures, those bad software programs secretly download to their computer. And everybody's, you know, these bad guys are watching for your credit card numbers and so forth. Mm. And this is one of the ways that your identity gets stolen. And people are just unaware of the technology, which is, again, one of the reasons I wrote this book.
Doesn't our antivirus software keep us safe?
I used to think so.
Oh, you used to?
I used to spend a lot of money on those programs. And don't get me wrong, you know, it's good to have those programs on your computer. But can I tell you what the experts are saying?
What are they saying?
The experts are saying that in their best estimation, based upon the available evidence, antivirus software might catch 30% of the viruses that are out there. You know, the problem is this. 2.2 seconds, a new virus enters into cyberspace.
Wait a minute. Say that.
Every 2.2 seconds, a new form of malware or a virus enters into cyberspace.
Oh.
Man, that's a lot, isn't it?
Oh, that's unbelievable.
That's 27 a minute.
Well, you know, thank the Lord for 30% anyway.
Well, 30% is good. You know, yeah. The other thing is that there are some steps that you can take to protect yourself. And, you know, I'm one of those people that doesn't like to just curse the darkness. I like to shine a light in the midst of the darkness.
Good.
So I tell people what they ought to do in this book to protect yourself.
All right.
It's not just the antivirus software, but there's other steps that you can take as well. You know, just to give you one quick hint, always update all your software whenever there's an update available.
You know what, Ron? I read that in your book, and this morning when I turned my computer on, it said, you know, you need to update this particular program. I hit it immediately. Sometimes I will just, you know, blow that off. You know, I can't be bothered now. This morning I hit it. Go ahead and update right now.
Well, so you and me both
convinced me.
It is real important because one of the primary ways where the bad guys find their way into your computer is through the software that you have on your computer. They find vulnerabilities in Microsoft Word or Adobe Acrobat or, you know, System 7, Microsoft Windows. And so whenever an update comes out, one of the purposes of those updates is to shut all the secret back doors that these bad guys are finding. If I might put it that way. There's not a literal backdoor, but it's sort of an electronic backdoor that the bad guys are looking for. Every update that comes out from your software company has as one of its purposes to shut those secret backdoors so the bad guys can't do their thing.
All right. We're talking today on Round the Country with Ron Rhodes. The name of his book is Cyber Meltdown. Now, Ron, let's talk in the time that we have left here, about 10 minutes. About the role of cyber technologies in end times Bible prophecy. How does all that mesh together?
Well, there's a number of things I can point to. And I've already mentioned the coming cashless society that will exist. That's when the Antichrist will control the entire world economy, and likely every one of the people who live will have an account number, and all the stores will have an account number, and all of this will be controlled through a master, interconnected computer system. But there's other things as well. For example, we read in Revelation 11 that there's two mighty witnesses of God who are coming. They're going to be prophetic witnesses who have mighty power, kind of like Moses and Elijah. And after a time, the Antichrist is going to put them to death, and their bodies are going to lay in Jerusalem. And the text of Scripture says, every eye on planet Earth will witness this. Well, it used to be 100 years ago, people wondered how that would happen. That's no longer a problem with today's television technology as well as internet feeds. I'm quite sure that the videos of that event will go viral on the internet with people watching that, no matter where they are. Scripture also speaks about a global government that's going to exist in the end times. Now, it used to be that it would be very difficult to actually bring about a global government, but today, virtually everything is interconnected. And as a result of that interconnectedness, especially on an economic level, it will be very easy for a charismatic individual to come along and bring about a unified world government. Even today, there are people who are crying out for solutions. It seems like the economy in Japan affects the economy in the United States. Whenever things are bad here, things are bad elsewhere. Our globe is interconnected. People all over the world are crying out for answers, and one day, an individual will emerge and bring about a world government, a global government, and our present technology makes it possible. I think also just in terms of the weaponry that that exists today, it makes possible for the fulfillment of certain biblical prophecies. You know, I'm thinking about, for example, how the book of Revelation tells us that after certain of the apocalyptic plagues that are unleashed on earth, one-third of all the grass and one-third of all the trees will be burned. Boy, that almost sounds nuclear, doesn't it?
Yeah.
You know, you wonder about how that ties into things. But that certainly is making it possible for the fulfillment of prophecies. There's just so much more that I could talk about here, but what I'm trying to do in this book is to show how our present technologies are actually setting the stage for the fulfillment of specific prophecies that will take place in the tribulation period. And I've provided, as you can see in the back of the book, just a mountain of footnotes.
Yes.
You know, I want people to know that this is thoroughly documented stuff.
All right. People are always interested in the mark of the beast. We know the Antichrist is coming. Everyone will have a mark or be required to have the mark of the beast. But in your book, you say the mark itself is not high technology. Explain that.
Well, really, it's technology that makes it possible for the Antichrist to enforce the mark of the beast. Now, it's kind of interesting how the Antichrist is counterfeiting our own Lord and our own God. Because you might remember in Revelation 7 and 14 that God puts a mark on his own people, the 144,000, in order to keep them safe. And these are the people who are totally committed to God. They are Jewish evangelists who will witness all over the world, and God puts his mark on them. Well, the Antichrist is a copycat. He's building his own kingdom. And so all people who don't follow God are to receive the mark of the beast. And how will that mark be enforced? How will the Antichrist actually succeed in making people be loyal to him? Well, he'll have a situation such that if you do not receive the mark of the beast, you will not buy or sell anything. In other words, you're going to be forced to choose either submit to the beast or starve. And there's not going to be any middle ground.
Mm-hmm.
A polarization will take place whether you're either for God or you're for the Antichrist. And so the mark of the beast is something that is distinct from the technology, but the technology is what makes it possible for the Antichrist to actually enforce the mark of the beast.
Mm. People are always trying to point to the Antichrist. Oh, he is this person, he's that person. Always trying to identify him.
Yes.
We don't really, as Christians, well, we need to know about, but we don't need to be concerned because we're not going to be here, right?
Oh, I don't think we're going to be here. We're going to beam out of here right before all that takes place. And it's an event called the rapture. And
yes,
at the rapture, we're going to be caught up to meet the Lord in the air, at which point you and I will receive a wonderful body upgrade. Amen. No more cholesterol, no more heart problems, uh-huh. No more hairs falling out of your head, you know. Going to be just awesome, but we're going to be taken out before the tribulation period begins, and so we shouldn't be concerned about that anyway. In fact, Scripture says that this man will not be revealed to the earth until the restrainer is taken out of the way, and the restrainer is the Holy Spirit who lives in the church.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to take place at the rapture.
Just let me say this. Ron has included many, 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 many scriptures on all of these things that he's saying now. So it is biblical. And another thing, Ron, that you do just touch on is that the Antichrist possibly could be alive today. Not revealed, but could be alive, correct?
Well, that's correct. In fact, there's a lot of scholars, including some of my old professors at Dallas Seminary, who say that Satan has had his man living in every age. Satan does not have omniscience like God does. He doesn't know the exact, precise timing of all the prophecies, so therefore he's had a man ready in every age to step in and fulfill the role of the Antichrist. And so there's no doubt someone living in our own day today that Satan has picked out who would fulfill that role if these other prophecies that the scriptures speak about should come to fulfillment. And so I think that there's a lot of excitement in our day. There's no other time in which I'd rather be alive, mm-hmm. because I do believe that we are in the end times and that what we're seeing today is actually setting the stage for the fulfillment of prophecy in the future.
How then should we live as end times Christians? You begin with discern the signs of the times, and that's what you've done for us in this book. But continue on.
Well, what I've tried to do is to not get Christians all alarmist about this. I do want them to be aware about all of this. But at the same time, I want to light a candle and let you know that God is in control. And as we live as biblical Christians in the end times, we must always trust in God no matter what happens. I don't care if there's threats of wars. I don't care if there's threats of invasions. No matter what is taking place on the earth, God exhorts us to trust in Him, period. God is the one who controls human history. He is guiding it towards its culmination. And it's also interesting in Scripture that whenever God gives us details about the end times, He follows it up by saying, trust me.
Yes.
Don't have fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear, so trust in God in all things. So that's the kind of Christian that we ought to be today.
Absolutely.
And if you're that kind of Christian, don't you want to also live righteously and in purity?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's what God calls us to do in light of the fact that we're living in the end times.
Especially, yes. Oh, Ron, thank you so much. Our time has just flown by so quickly. But there is so much in Ron Rhodes' book, Cyber Meltdown. Get a copy of it. It's published by Harvest House. And I'm sure that it's available in your Christian bookstore, online, wherever you pick up your Christian books. Cyber Meltdown by Ron Rhodes. Ron, thank you again. I'm sure we'll talk to you another time.
I look forward to it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Goodbye now.
Bye-bye.
God bless you.
You too.